Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Sing out. Let it.
Should have been dead. 4 hours later, he's teasing the nurse. He's home in less than 24 hours, wasn't it?
Amen.
Praise God.
That's God.
Pastor Dina's mother. Now, I know that, you know, I've been talking about pastors, but I know Pastor Dina feeds off of her mama. There's a bond there where they, mama's got a lot of influence in her.
Amen.
Look where she's sitting here now. Couldn't take her out. Carmen. You guys remember the singer Carmen? Mm-hmm. Just had a massive widowmaker. He's back on tour. Jesse DeFrance this past year had to have an open heart surgery. And my wife made a connection there, and I think there's something to it. Things are accelerating in the body of Christ, but they're accelerating in the world too. If you don't believe it, in the last 7 years, one thing we've accomplished, we don't know what bathroom to go to. You don't think things aren't accelerating in the world? Satan is attacking the heart of the church. He's going after the pastors. But it's not working because we're seeing victory after victory after victory. We've seen a victory in the last 2 years here in your own church. Pastor Mike was blessed with a lovely, wonderful wife. That's a miracle in itself.
Terrible part of the Red Sea.
in our church over there in Morton, we set goonies every year. And we write them out. Pastor Bob has them published in a book. And it's really neat because we can go back and look at them. And we set goals for victories we want to see in this coming year. Not only my goals, but I get to see Danny and Anita's and Darlene's and Pastor Bob and Pastor Deb's and Pastor Vince's and Hank's and Sheila's. We get to lift each other up and help each other establish those goals.
Amen.
And we'll get into a little bit more of why we do that later. But we're seeing spiritual growth. We're seeing family victories. We're seeing financial victories. There's a couple back there. I'm not going to tell you who they are. But I'm sure they'll let me share this little bit of testimony. In the last year and a half, I've seen this couple sell their house and get more than what they were asking for because God bless them. I've seen him lose his job. And before he can get out and start looking for a job, people were calling him, offering him better jobs than he had.
Amen.
So we're seeing victories in the body of the church. In the Old Testament, y'all remember Joseph? I was named after him. His brothers were a little bit jealous of him. They threw him in a pit. He went from the pit to the palace. And in doing so, his brothers ended up bowing down to him, and he saved the nation. What was meant for evil, God turned it around. How about the Moses? He went from the basket in the creek to the palace to run it for his life and coming back and leading children of Israel. Spent 40 years with them. They were complaining the whole time. But God blessed him. Daniel. They threw him in, what was it, the fire? What does the scripture say? The fire was so hot that when the guards opened the door, they fell over dead from it? I'm still trying to figure out if they fell over dead. How'd they get him in the fire? Did he just walk in there or what? But he came back out. He wasn't even scorched. And then there was Joshua. Tonight, we're going to take a little bit of a look at Joshua and his fight of faith where Jericho was overthrown. It was a well-rounded faith. It was the kind of faith that we got to have. If we're going to be victorious, we need to have a faith like Joshua. And there were some key things that happened in there that I want to share with you. Go to Joshua chapter 1, verse 3. Everybody there? Every place on which the sole of your foot treads, I have given it to you, just as I spoke to Moses. From the wilderness and this Lebanon, even as far as the great river and the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, and as far as the great sea towards the setting of the sun will be your territory. No man will be able to stand before you all the days of your life. Just as I have been with Moses, I will be with you. I will not fail you or forsake you. Be strong and courageous, for you shall give this people possession of the land which I swore your fathers to give them. Only be strong and very courageous. Be careful to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn to the right or to the left, so that you may have success wherever you go. The book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have success. Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous? Do not tremble or be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. How many people believe that?
Amen.
How many people believe God's with you no matter where you go?
Amen.
No matter what you're facing, do you really believe God's there?
Yes.
Good. Because when we get done here at the end of this, I'm going to challenge you to do something. And it's his fault. He keeps challenging us. So it's my turn. I get to challenge you. He gave me a challenge. I know some of you have seen it on Facebook. He gave me a challenge about a month ago. He says, I want you to help me build a wall, a closet in my study. 3 weeks later, after we completely renovated the study, Now, that's not the scary part. The scary part was when he looked at me and said, all the plans are in my head. I had to go in there. A place where no man should have to go. And I said, my God, he's merciful. But we have fun, and I got to tell you, so we did have fun. And I'm not picking on Pastor Bob, because he asked me not to build this by myself, but to teach him how to do these things. And it was fun. And he learned very, very quickly. And he don't need me anymore now. But the funniest part of it is his wife had a father who was into woodworking and stuff and had all these tools, and she's seen him growing up. So I couldn't hold my laughter back when she looks up and she's all excited. And she goes, Bob, we can go shopping at Harbor Freight together now. Okay, that's enough story picking on him. But notice the key part of what I mentioned there was be strong and courageous. Do not tremble or be dismayed, for the Lord God is with you wherever you go. Pastor Dana, I gave her, she knew the song. I had a CD, I gave it to her. Mike Atkins, there's a song in there. Don't give up on the brink of a miracle. I wonder how many times we've had to face something and God didn't respond the way we wanted him to, or as fast as we wanted him to. We got discouraged and we stopped. Well, if we held on just one more day, our miracle was there. Be strong. Be courageous. You want to walk in victory. You can't give up. No matter what's facing you, you cannot give up. You know, if you're facing something that the doctor says is going to take your life, what's the worst thing it can do? Destroy your body? So you blink your eyes and you're in heaven. Where's the threat? Now, I don't want that overbooked. I might stay around some of my grandkids get buried and stuff. But I'm just saying, if you think about it, where is the threat? Go to Joshua chapter 6, verse 2. And I'm going to try to get all you guys out of here. I know the kids got school and all and everything, so I hope we'll get you out of here by at least 11 o'clock. No, I'm not Pastor Mike. You're safe. You know, I got to tell you, Pastor Bob, and Pastor Rick can attest to this, Pastor Bob takes great pleasure in his messages mentioning my age. And yet I keep reminding him, he's a year and a few days older than I am, and I'm better looking. So, I don't know why he keeps doing it, but he does. Joshua chapter 6, verse 2, and the Lord said to Joshua, see, I have given Jericho into your hand, its king and the mighty men of valor. You know what? Joshua was standing there in a full view of him. Here was this fortress, these huge walls. But Joshua was not moved because God had already promised him, I've given it to you. Now, the perfect tense in Hebrew of that word means I have already. So God's telling him something that he's already done, even though the walls are still standing there, but Joshua stood on that promise. He told me that that was mine. All my people have to do is believe it and step into it. There's promises that God has given every one of you in here. If you just stand and believe in it and accept it, receive it. I never thought I'd be where I'm at today. I live my life when I got married, I told people I never lived to see 30. And I believe that. If you see how I live my life, you know, there's people that live their life right at the edge. That wasn't me. I lived my life over the edge, and it kept coming back. Yeah. I climb in race cars and do things that you're not supposed to do. No, any second I could get killed. The adrenaline rush kept me going. But there's not one thing I've ever done, there's no drug I've ever taken that's ever got me as high as the anointing of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Amen. It will change your life. Since God declared it, the victory had already been won. Victorious Christians are people who know the promises of God because they spend time meditating on God's word. I'm going to ask you a question. Please do not answer. I don't want to see your hands. I just want you to be honest with yourself. Don't answer this. How many people here read and meditate God's word every day? Don't answer it. It's rhetorical. Answer it yourself. I don't know. But if you want to be victorious, this is one of the things you've got to do. You listen to people and you see things and they're having victory in their life. There's couples in here now that I know that have personally testified that they're up at 6 o'clock in the morning having devotions together. That's something that, I'll be honest with you, that's something my wife and I have not done. We're going to, just so they're not going to convince her to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning. It's not a problem for me, I generally am, but she likes to sleep till about 8, so we may have to have devotions a little later. So. But the point is, it's something that God started to impress on me that we need to do as a couple. Because I want to be victorious. We have goals that we have set, and we're seeing it. We're getting closer and closer and closer. And I want to see those goals met. They believe the promises of God, because they understand that the Word of God generates faith in your heart. What does Scripture say? Faith comes by hearing, hearing the Word of God. How can you grow faith if you don't hear the words? They don't just hear them, but they reckon on these promises and obey what God tells them. Now, for all you northern folks that don't know what reckoning is, that means they believe that it's true. You know, they don't doubt it, they reckon it's true. Christ conquered the world, the flesh, and the devil. And if we reckon on his truth, the battle has already been won through him. Now, how many people understand that it is possible to believe a promise and not act on it? Pastor Rick, if I write you a check and I hand it to you, that check's a promise. But that check won't do him a bit of good if he don't cash it. He gets nothing out of it if he don't cash it. You can read these promises and you can believe all these promises, but if you don't put some action behind them, you're standing there holding a check that's doing you no good. So the first thing we got to understand about Joshua the battle is that the battle was already won. Verse 4, all 7 priests shall carry 7 trumpets and ram horns before the ark. Then on the 7th day you shall march around the city 7 times, and the priests shall hold the trumpets. It shall be that when they make a long blast with a ram's horn, and when you hear the sound of the trumpet, all the people shall shout with a great shout, and the wall of the city shall fall flat, and the people will go up, every man straight ahead. Notice there were some conditions. One of the conditions was you have to have obedience to be victorious. You have to walk. You have to take an action. Like the check was covered up. You can't just sit there and hold it. There is an action that has to be put in place in order to be a victorious person. You have to watch and be aware of what's going on around you. Be sensitive to where he's leading you and what he's asking you to do. We have young pastors in our church. And then let me tell you something, people. Just because a pastor may only be in his 30s, don't underestimate that they have wisdom, because we have young pastors in our churches that are taught. This old boy. We have a young pastor, Pastor Jeff, he's not here tonight. He told me one of the first things he ever told me was this generation out there today, they're very argumentative. Don't get pulled into an argument with them, you'll lose. I've never forgotten that. And I ran into that. He knew what he was talking about. And we have young pastors that they don't know what the future is going to be. Some of our young pastors, 10 years from now, might be pastoring their own churches. Wouldn't that be a victory? And they're sitting back there going, I don't know about that. Breathe back there going, what you talking about? But we got to wait. We have to have the right attitude. We got to be able to receive the promises. We got to be able to obey God. But we got to do it in his time of truth. I know people, I'm not going to mention names, but I know people who's got a little bit ahead of the pull of the cart there. Man, I had to back up a little bit. You got to have the right attitude. The other thing that you have to do is in Joshua verse 10. Now Joshua had commanded the people, saying, you shall not shout or make any noise with your voice, nor shall a word proceed out of your mouth until the day I say to you, shout, then you shall shout. And I had some really good comments to be there, but I had great wisdom, and my wife told me, shut your mouth. She says, you don't know how many women's going to be there. It's a long way to that door. So I'm not saying anything other than saying, sometimes we need to shut up.
That's right. Amen.
Children of Israel spent 40 years in the desert. One of the main reasons they spent all that time is because they couldn't shut up and kept complaining about everything. I mean, come on, God guided them. He provided them with food, everything they needed, and they could. You cannot have victory in your life if you don't learn to shut your mouth. I can't receive my healing if I get up every day walking around going, oh, I just feel miserable today. This thing is just kicking my backside. Oh, how long is it going to be, Lord, before you deliver? No. There was a young lady who was supposed to be here tonight. She's not, so I can say this. She had the right confession. She's a friend of ours, and she came to us and some other friends here a few weeks back. She had some health issues here. Could have been serious. This was her confession. I want you guys to stand in agreement and pray for me, because I've got to go through all these tests and everything, and they're saying that these are the possibilities. But I received a word from God that He's got my back. I'm going to go through it, not to worry about it. He's got it covered. What a confession. Mama Word over here, woohoo! I learned from her, believe me. But why, man, you know what that struck me? You were the first one I thought of. I thought, man, you would be proud of her. She had the right confession. She didn't come in here going, oh, I've got to have all these tests, and I may have this, and I may have that. She came in here and said, oh, I received the word from God. I'm going through this. I'm not staying here. I'm going through it. But He's got my back. I'm already taken care of. You understand? You getting it? You can't get a financial breakthrough if you're constantly complaining about being broke, busted, and disgusted.
Amen. Amen.
Now that don't mean you've got to go out and try to buy $500,000 home and you only got $10,000. But that don't mean you've got to sit around whining about what you don't have, be content with what you've got, and start confessing that God is bringing you more. See, honey, I got out of it without seeing it. Jump down to 6:21. And they utterly destroyed all that was in the city, man and woman, young and old, ox and sheep and donkey, with the edge of the sword. Finally, God's purpose was to bless the nation of Israel and use her to be a channel for blessing the world. But He knew that there could not be anything left from the old religion that was there, because it was religion of prostitution and child sacrifice. Sin is contagious. A little bit of it went a long way. He knew that. That had to be totally wiped out. In your life, if you want total victory, you can't stop halfway. You've got to go all the way. If you're struggling with alcoholism and you want to be delivered, you can't keep a bottle hid somewhere just in case. If you're struggling with pornography, you can't keep a Playboy between the mattresses. You're not going to be delivered because you're not letting go and you're still holding on to that sin. If you gossip, thank you, Mary. That'd be a mean girl. But you get the point of what I'm saying. You cannot hold on to something and expect deliverance from the same time. You cannot expect to be forgiven if you can't forgive others. Pastor Bob's got a great teaching on that. And sometimes that's hard to do. There are people in my life that I didn't want to forgive. My sister and my niece is going through something now that's going to take some forgiveness. Did you guys see the thing in the paper about the young man in East Peoria that was stabbed last night and killed? That was my niece's boyfriend. She just broke up with him not too long ago. It was a good friend of theirs that they grew up with. They killed him. My sister, my niece especially, is going to have to deal with some forgiveness. She's going to need a lot of prayers because that's not going to be easy. And she can do it. If she gets her heart in the right place and trust in God, she can do it. Another thing we want to look at as victory is what looks like to be defeat can be victory. Remember Joseph? His brothers thought they had him. Yeah, I wonder what Joseph thought. All of the things that he went through. I mean, from being thrown in the pit, being sold into slavery, being in the mansion, being in prison, being there. You kind of wonder what was going through his head. But he never lost sight of the fact that God had given him a vision of what he would be. He hung on to that. And that's something you and I have got to do too. We've got to understand. If we're wrong by a fellow brother or sister, you've got to totally forgive them. Pastor Mike, I told Pastor Bob last week, we was working on a house. This is embarrassing to say. But Pastor Mike, I understand. So were a lot of you. That out there does not scare me. There is nothing out there that really scares me. This scares me. I have dealt with more persecution, more hurt, more backstabbing from so-called brothers and sisters in the church than anywhere. And that's a shame. And it happens. And when it does, you've got to be willing to forgive them. And that's not always easy. Pastor Bob, I'm not going to get into it. Pastor Rick was supposed to preach here a couple of weeks ago. And he got up there and God changed the direction he was going. And it's on the TV, on the YouTube. The message was called Church Heritage. And he went back and discussed things that him and Pastor Bob had gone through. You already heard Pastor Bob's testimony. God gave him a vision for what we're doing today 30 years ago. And the devil tried to kill that. I'm not going to go into, you don't even know the names or anything else. Just let me say this. Somebody within the body of Christ wronged him. And Satan used that and tried to take him out. And he went through a living hell. But he didn't give up. Which is why he started fulfilling the vision. Satan tried to kill him with God. He didn't give up to anything. And look where he's at now. And for those that don't know it, Pastor Bob is a pastor's pastor. He raises up pastors to launch them out. And Pastor Rick, if I can repeat this right, correct me if I'm wrong, if all the people that have come and gone under his ministry in the last 30 years were here today, we could not contain them here. Keep that thought in mind and remember it, because the challenge is going to come back to that. If you're going to walk in total victory, you must forgive yourself. Amen. And that, my friends, is the hardest forgiveness you'll ever face. There are things that I did in my life. I'm going to tell you something from personal experience. You will never be happy and you will never be victorious until you can look in the mirror and like the person that's staring back at you. Until you accept who you are, what you've done, and accept the fact that everything you've done, God has forgiven it and forgotten it. When you can look in that mirror and say, I really like that guy. You must forgive yourself. It's not an option. If you want to be victorious, it has to be done. Okay. I don't know what that was, but... In our church, We have a sign that's on the wall. And I love it because it says, this is not church as usual. This is a training camp. I grew up in synagogue churches. We didn't sit there and laugh and have fun like this. But really, isn't this what church is supposed to be? Aren't you supposed to enjoy yourself when you're here?
Yes.
It's great to be able to have a little bit of fun with each other. It's relaxing. It keeps you awake. It keeps you alert. And it helps the Word of God get into you. We're anointed to be victorious. John, 1 John 5:4 says, for whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world. Our faith. If you believe that Jesus is the Son of God and you're born of God, you've already won the battle.
Yes.
You know, I could say some things that would be controversial to some of them, but here's one of them. I run into people that, how you doing? Oh, I'm tired. I've just been fighting the devil all week long. What? Why are you fighting him? He's a defeated foe.
Right.
What scripture say? Resist him. He has to flee. Get out of here. Sarah, I ain't got time for you. You're wasting my time. Get out of here, though. But I run into people all the time. Well, I'm so beat up. I've been fighting. Well, we're fighting. He's got thousands of years of experience. You really want to go 10 rounds with him? I don't want to go one round with him. He's good. If you walk in faith, then obedience to God's commandments should not be difficult. One of the big things that, and I was telling Pastor Bob this the other day, one of the big things that happened when I got connected with Grace Ministries, it used to be a struggle to get out of bed and go to church. It took a conscious effort on my part to actually do that. It took a hard effort to go to a midweek service. But when I got connected to Grace Ministries and I started learning really how to walk in faith and stuff, I don't think about it anymore. I get up on Sunday morning and it's just habit for me. It's what I want to do. The desires of my heart greatly have changed. I mean, we can't do it all the time, but there's times on Sunday night we come down here and visit you guys. Just because it's fun, I enjoy it. There's other churches I went in I went over to Bloomington, Pastor Tim's once in a while. But I went from it being very difficult to assemble myself together to I can't wait. I mean, there's times when things come up that I can't be there and I miss it. But the difficulty has been removed. Now I want to. I enjoy it. I desire to be. Now we've talked about past victories. Now we're going to go to future victories. We're going to do a little flip-flop here. We're going to come back in 2016. And we're going to pick up Pastor Bob for a minute again. First off, understand something. We've seen great victories. I want to see little victories. And I'll explain that here in just a second. But the first thing we got to do is we have to understand we're one kingdom.
Yes.
I'm Pastor Joe. This is Pastor Mike. This is Pastor Rick. This is Pastor Deb. Pastor Bob. There's Pastor Aaron Bree back here. Pastor Danny and Anita. Before long, we'll start calling her pastor. There's Pastor Vince. There's Pastor Dina. We are one body. We are one team. We serve one man.
Amen.
That's the first thing we've got to do, is get that through our heads, that there is no competition. We serve one man. Anytime Pastor Bob has a victory in his life, I have a victory. Pastor Mike has a victory. You have a victory.
Amen.
Because we serve one man, and that victory is his.
Yes.
Pastor Bob takes great fun in teasing me. Because he was in the Army. I'm sorry. I was in the Navy. And he likes to point out that he didn't know what we did in the Navy. And I have to remind him that if it wasn't for us, they wouldn't be here. Because every time the Army would go in the jungles and get themselves in trouble, they call us to bail them out so they can get back home. And after we bailed him out and got him back home, they called the Air Force to come in with heavy bombs and wipe everything out. But the bottom line is this. It didn't matter if we were in the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, the Marines. Well, maybe the Air Force. We all worked for one man. He was called Commander-in-Chief. He was President of the United States.
Yes.
And maybe not so much right now, but when we were in there, we had a Commander-in-Chief that it was an honor to serve for that man. So when he had a victory in the Army, the Navy, the Marines, the Air Force had a victory. Because it was a victory for this nation. When Pastor Mike has a victory, we have a victory because it's a victory for God's nation. That's where the little victories are going to come in. This is where I'm going to start to challenge you a little bit. Pastor Mike, you did something here a couple weeks ago when I was visiting. I don't remember what it was now, but you flopped a chair out here and sat here with a remote whining about how much trouble the world's in. Can't understand why God's not doing anything. And that hit me. That hit me. I understood that. That's the church. And that's what you said. This is the church. I don't understand. Turn the channel. Oh, man, there's another mess. I don't understand what's going on. God's got to do something. Let me tell you something. I could open the doors right now. I could yell at the top of my lungs and say, hey, we're talking about Jesus. Come on in. Chances are not one person walked through there. You know why? God never told the world to go to the church. He told the church to go to the world.
Amen.
We got it backwards. And we've had it backwards for a long time. We've been so busy and so worried about building numbers. And it's never been about the world going to the church. It's been about us taking it to the streets. I was looking at the lyrics for that. Doobie Brothers, taking it to the streets. Yeah. You don't know me, but I'm your brother. And I don't think I like what you're about to show me. There's a dying world out there that's begging for us to come see. Jesus didn't tell us to work really hard to gather people into large crowds and fill up church buildings. Then I know he loved me. But if we look at some of our pastors and some of our churches, you would think that's what he said. We got big churches, but there ain't no move of God in them. There's a move in them, but it ain't a move of God in them. And I'm not trying to be critical, but that's just a reality. And people start talking about, I long for the old days. The good old days when God was moving. Don't. You're setting yourself up for defeat.
That's right.
Time only travels one way, forward. You can't go backwards. Now here's something that's going to throw you for a loop. And God's been dealing with me with this subject here, and I said something to Pastor Bob, and he, I don't remember exactly how he said it now, but it tied it all together for me. But do you realize that we are on our third generation of unchurched people? There's people out there in the world that's never been in a church. When I was growing up, I could not imagine, I couldn't believe this, that there was nobody in this country that didn't know who Jesus was. Today, I'm not shocked to find out that there's people who've never been in a church and don't know who Jesus is. And if you think that's impossible, let me tell you something. I watched an interview that one of the reporters sent out, one of the reporters to a beach and asked people in the ages of 20 to 35 different questions. They asked questions like, who was the first president? I don't know. They asked a 30-year-old African-American man, what was the Civil War about? He says, I don't have a clue. Now, if he don't have a clue what the Civil War is about, you think he knows what Jesus was about? Three generations of an unchurched world. We need to emphasize what Jesus and the disciples did. He told us to ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore to send out workers into the harvest field. See, it's not about numbers. It's about letting him use us to share the love to his people that we encounter in our life. It's not about filling a building. See if I can explain this now. And I said this to Pastor Bob because unchurched people, we keep praying for a revival and we need it. But you're not going to revive the world because there's unchurched people out there that's never been in a service and never felt the Spirit. There's nothing there to revive. But when revival begins, it begins here in us. And the whole purpose of the revival, I really don't want to see these churches filled. I want to see these churches emptied. When you leave here on a Sunday all week long, here's your challenge. When you're out there in that world, Rosemary, when you're at work, and that customer comes in there, that door opens. Use that opportunity to witness. Aaron, when you're on the job, hey, when you're towing a car in there, if you will let God use you and take this out to the street in love, not condemnation. People don't know nothing about God out there. They don't know what they're doing is wrong. Don't go out there trying to beat them up. Go out there and present them a love and a peace and someone that can change their lives. And you'd be surprised how the opportunities. I heard a man one day, I don't recommend this, but I heard a man one day using the Lord's name in vain. He was working on a car, I was walking by, and he might get him up, wait, wait, and I said, stop turning. I looked at him and I said, I don't think he had anything to do with it. He looks at me and goes, oh. I said, God, I don't think he had anything to do with it. I'm pretty sure a man did this. But he started laughing and the door flew open. And I got to stand there and talk to him about God. Now, here's something I want you to think about too. When you get out here, there's people who's going to laugh at you. There's people who will insult you. They'll ridicule you. Not everybody's going to receive what you're going to say right then. But here's something that I honestly believe. That person that's standing there ridiculing you and making fun of you, inside their heart, they're screaming, don't let this offend you. Don't give up on me. I'm not ready today, but I need to know your Jesus.
Yeah.
Don't let it offend you. Plant that seed. Because you know what? You may plant this. Rosemary, you may plant the seed. They may go into Kim's and get her hair cut. Kim may add water. They may run into Pastor Bob. He may get the harvest. Doesn't matter who got the harvest. We all got victory because we got a victory for one nation, God's nation.
That's right.
But if we will get off our keisters, I'll explain to you northern folks what that is. You said only that. If we get off our keisters and get out here in the streets and start sharing this gospel with people, we're going to see the revival. The revival is going to break out in us. And it's going to generate a new move of God that these people have never seen, that they will come into the churches. Our churches are growing. But if we continue down a path of just staying here and doing nothing, that's not what God called us to do. He told us to go out, preach the gospel, make disciples. Every experience that we have should be for two reasons. When we go out there, we should be magnifying the risen Christ. And like Pastor Bob, we should be training people to go out and to better serve and witness to people. We need to be pushing back. You know, I'm not going to get political. Pastor Bob mentioned this, and I agree with him 100%. Well, there's two things first. And Danny, it's in my notes. We were talking about this when you came in. We are called to work for restoration and renewal, for transformation, to put our feet to the faith. But in the end, we have stand on the promise that God will give us the words to say. And trust me, I've been there. I've been nervous. I've been scared. But I discovered that if I open my mouth and say two words, my wife can attest to this. There's been times I've walked away and I looked at her and I said, where'd all that come from? Because they just come bubbling out. You don't have to quote them scripture. You don't even think that. You can paraphrase it. You know it. It's in you. Pastor Bob makes a comment that everybody in our church, and I believe that that's true here too. Every one of you here are equipped. Every one of you have enough of the word in there that if you'll trust the Holy Spirit's leading, when it leads you to talk with somebody out there, just trust him open your mouth. He'll give you the words to say. Am I right? You won't be quoting scripture, you don't have to be. But he'll give you what you need to say if you just trust him. Our hopes are not in the rearview mirror. It's in the looking through the windshield. We gotta quit looking back and start looking in the future. Yeah. Now, for the political thing that I'm not gonna get, we got an election coming up. It doesn't matter if Mo, Curly, or Larry wins that election. Our hope is not in who's sitting in that White House. Our hope is in our ability to change the hearts of people. You are not going to legalize morality. Sorry, it's not going to happen. You're not going to legally outlaw abortion. It's not going to happen. But if you change people's hearts, you can make it go away.
Yes.
But we can't do it if we stay here. We've got to get out in the streets. Every place we go. You remember the movie War Room? I love that movie. If you haven't seen it, I'm not going to ruin it for you. I'm just going to tell you the very, very ending. No. I'm not going to ruin it because there's only one line I want to use. There's a lady praying, "Lord, send me another." Mm-hmm. That should be our prayer before we leave the house. Send me just one today, Lord. Give me that one opportunity to be a vessel, a witness for you. Send me one a day, Lord. Let me tell you something else, too. How many people we got in the business world here? I know you run it. How many people we got in the business world? Pastor Bob, you're in it. Pastor Bob probably attested this morning, buddy. There's times when you go to talk to somebody, you ask them how they're doing, and they'll start to say something. Listen to how the Spirit shut up. Don't say nothing. Because if you just shut up and listen, you give them 2 minutes, and they'll start dumping out what's really bothering them. And boy, the door will fly wide open to witness them. Here's some other advice. I can't tell you how to do this. I'm going to tell you what works for me. Don't go out here and try to tell them what God can do for them. Tell them what God's done for you.
Yeah. Amen.
Be the witness. Amen. So you know what? I've been down that road. I've been right where you were at. But God, I met somebody who changed my life and radically turned it around. I've never been so happy. Tell them what God's done for you. Pastor Mike's standing on the street corner on the other side of the street. Somebody's talking over here about God. He ain't talking to him, but it changed his life. Sometimes we just got to shut up and let the other people talk in order for the door to open up. In closing, I just want to ask yourself these minor questions. When you're out in the public, you're at work or wherever, the people you meet, do they see Jesus in you? Is there something different about you that sparks their curiosity? Well, man, he's always happy. She's always got a smile. What is with her? She ain't normal. They said that about me all the time. You know. But you understand, we're supposed to be the light of the world. And our light should be shining when we walk in. Darkness starts backing up. Whoa. Jesse DePinus made a comment one day that he wanted to be the point when his feet hit the floor, the demon starts screaming, "Oh, he's up." We laugh about that, but really, isn't that where we should be?
Yes.
We should be, when we wake up and start moving, demons are start shaking, going, "Oh, that light's getting brighter. We got to hide today." So let me ask you this question, and I'll close with this. Are you ready to win a battle or two for the Commander-in-Chief? Are you ready to take it to the streets? Remember, I got started, so the bar is going to get higher each night. You definitely want to be here. Pastor Tim's here tomorrow. For those of you who were here at the last conference we had with Pastor Tim, that bar could go way up tomorrow. So, Pastor Bob, Pastor Mike, who?
Thursday
is Pastor Tanya. Friday is, who's here Friday? Oh, Pastor Mike's here Friday. You don't want to miss that. I pick on him, but I love the man. I love hearing him teach. He has a unique way of teaching that you can understand things. Saturday night, Pastor Bob, Pastor Deb are going to tag team. You don't want to miss that. And of course, you know, Sunday night we got Kentucky Jim Schreiner. And you don't want to miss that. Pastor Jim is a riot. So that's it. Who wants to